Welcome to our fourth webinar of the webinar series on agricultural value chains. So when developing a value chain actually, it always implies changes in the way operators along the chain perform their business. When they, for example, choose to adopt a new technology or improve their product, they automatically develop their own business model. But for developing it, and also in order to improve it, it's very important to analyze your business model in order to know what specifically you have to improve. And this is why this webinar today focuses specifically on the analysis of business models. And for this, we have today Jens Windel with us from the Global Program Promotion of Agricultural Finance for Agri-based Enterprises in Rural Areas, and Fabian Zegowitz, Planning Officer, and they will share their experiences with us. Furthermore, we have Alfons Eilikmann and Andreas Springer-Heinze with us, who will inform us about tools from the ValueLinks 2.0 manual. And please, as always, feel free to ask questions, comment on the slides by using the chat function, or just unmute your microphone and ask. And with this, I think we can start with the first question. And therefore, I hand over to you, Alfons.
Good morning, everybody, also from my side. Welcome to our webinar. And like last time, we would like to start with two questions to bring you in and to start a discussion with you right from the beginning. So our first question to you would be whether you agree or disagree to the following sentence: some business models have net advantages for value chain development. If we promote these models, many value chain actors will benefit. Agree, disagree? Why or why not? Question two would be, we are knowledgeable value chain development experts. We are able to advise value chain actors on what is a good business model to invest. Is this right? Is this wrong? Would you rather say sometimes? And third, we would like to have any other comments from you on these questions. How do you see that? Then let me start with our first question.
Yes, thank you, Alfons. This is for you, the first one. So what is a business model?
Yeah. And also there, I'm not sure how our audience would see this term. Also there, if you have any suggestion, any idea how you would describe or define a business model, give us your comment in the chat function. From our side, we would define it as follows. We would say a business model is a specific combination of product and markets, internal operations and technology, supply and marketing links that an enterprise uses to succeed and grow. We can say it's a certain way how a company is doing its business. A business model is a term that is used mostly, as far as I can see, since a few years only. There's a lot of literature that came up in the year 2010. And also Wikipedia defines it with a term from a publication in 2010. A business model shows the rationale of how an individual firm creates, captures, and delivers value. And this Wikipedia takes from a book to which also ValueLinks 2.0 refers a lot, which is called the Business Model Generation. The advantage of a business model concept is that it allows discussing the key elements of a business in a quick and structured manner. In our ValueLinks trainings, I always compare it with a TV series in Germany. Some of you may know the TV series Die Höhle der Löwen. I think in English it's The Lion's Cave, where startups have 5 or 10 minutes to explain their business concept to investors. It is a short presentation, 5 to 10 minutes only, but it should be very clear how the startup works, what value it creates, what cost it has, how the startup will earn money, what profit it generates, and what investment is required for the startup. And this is very similar to the business model, or it's I think a perfect example of a business model. The business model explains the essentials. And we are also often asked the question, how does the term business model compare to business plan? And I would say there, a business plan usually is a often longer document that explains in detail the strategy of the company, the financial requirements, the cash flow, explains an action plan and has a financial statement that shows how the company will develop over the next few years. In general, this is much more detailed, more elaborated, whereas a business model is a bit like the, let's say, backbone of a business plan. It just presents the essentials of the business and how the business works. Much shorter. For us, also in value chain development, the advantage is that with the business model concept, or one advantage is that we can quickly distinguish between different types of actors at the same level in the value chain. For instance, different business models, how a farmer is doing his business, or different models of how to trade or process the product. And it enables us to have a closer look at the company level to see how certain companies work. And we are not always aggregating all the actors in the value chain together. There's one last point that I would like to mention here. We would like to say that every enterprise has a business model, either implicitly or explicitly. A small-scale traditional cocoa farmer in Ghana would probably not say that he has a certain business model, but he's doing his farming business in a certain way that is probably completely different from a large-scale cocoa plantation that employs workers, that uses machines, that may be producing certified cocoa. And therefore, it's good to be clear how different kinds of actors are doing their business, how we can structure them, how we can find out similarities among actors in the value chain. But everybody who has a company is following a certain business model.
Thank you, Alfons. So the next question goes to Andreas. Andreas, how can we describe a business model?
Yeah, thank you, Karina, for that question. Here is Andreas. Alfons already said every enterprise has a business model, and they should be able to describe what they are doing in a very short time. And there is one model and one tool that is very widespread recently and that can be filled in easily, providing a good starting point for describing a business model in more detail later. And we call that the business model canvas. The question was, how can we describe a business model? The answer, we do it through a business model canvas. And I start with a simplified format that you see has two lines. In the middle, you find the product. When we talk about value chains, we always start with the product as well. Every business is defined by the product it offers to its customers. In the language of the business model canvas, which is a tool that has been developed in the literature since a couple of years and that we've just borrowed, they call it value proposition. So the product is what the company proposes to its customers as value. And if you stay in the upper line of the business model canvas, you see to the left the processes that lead to that product, value creating activities, the resources you utilize, the partners and suppliers of those inputs and products that you use for production. On the right side to the product in the middle, you see the market linkages. So that is customer relationships, how you get to your customers, what are the channels for marketing. So if you like, the upstream and downstream linkages that the company entertains to make its products and to bring it to the customers. And of course, production causes cost, and the sale provides revenues that together will decide whether we make profits or loss. So both sides together are the basis for financial calculations. Now, this is the simplified version. I just wanted to show what the principle of the business model canvas is. The advantage is that you can fill that format with qualitative information. What are you doing? Who are your customers? What do you know about your cost and revenue? Doesn't have to be very detailed. But of course, the more you want to utilize it for business planning, the more you will have to go into specific questions related to these issues. And that is the following slide. I'm not going to present it now in detail, but the more complete format of the business model canvas has two more boxes that differentiate the picture a little more and a number of questions. The important point that I want to draw your attention to is cost and revenue. When I said that we are looking at qualitative information, obviously that's not the case when we talk about cost and revenue, because these are numbers. So here we have to do calculations, and the business model canvas presents just the result of such calculations. The calculation as such is a separate tool that we need to utilize in addition.
Thank you, Andreas. This was nice. So now we have a definition for business models. We know how to describe them, but how do they actually relate to value chains?
Yeah, exactly. That's the question, because we are talking about value chain development and not about the development of individual companies only. We always want to keep our value chain context. But in fact, there is a very close relationship between individual business models of companies and enterprises and the value chain at large. You all know the yellow boxes in our value chain maps. Each yellow box stands for a particular type of enterprise. Now, of course, that depends on the degree of detail in our value chain mapping, whether we are just presenting broad categories or go into specific business models, very much a question of how detailed we do value chain mapping. But we can still say that every enterprise has one. And so it could even be that you say every enterprise is different, and therefore there are different business models everywhere. But in fact, if you look at the most common value chains we are working with in agriculture, the SMEs, the farmers, often share a particular type of doing business and in fact follow the same business model. So I think makes sense to aggregate and talk about types of business models present in a value chain. Now, below on that slide, you see an excerpt, I should say, of a value chain map. In the middle, we have the rice mill. So it is a rice value chain, and we are talking about rice mills. So this is an individual company. Let's focus on it. And of course, that rice mill has a business model. The point that I'd like to make is that we can already determine some elements of the business model from looking at the position that that rice mill has in the value chain. So it transforms paddy into rice. So therefore, resources it's using, one of the important resources is paddy, of course, the raw material. The product or value proposition is the rice it delivers to traders and to the market. It has therefore upward and downward linkages. And then processes within the company, and that is the transformation, the processing from paddy to rice. So you can see that by depicting, by making a value chain map, you already have a starting point for describing a business model. Certainly not all the elements of it, but important elements are already implicit in a value chain map. If you go to the business model canvas again, we see that the different companies, different enterprises in the value chain are closely connected along the value chain. If we take two different companies in the value chain and look at them side by side, we see that Of course, each of it has a business model, separate business model, because they are in separate boxes, but they connect through the business linkage, say between a paddy trader and a rice mill. For the paddy trader, the rice mill is the customer. For the rice mill, the paddy trader is, of course, an input supplier, a partner. So the two elements in the respective canvases of both connect closely, and you could, depending on how close their relationship is, talk about an integrated or interlinked business model that somehow combines the two because they are so closely collaborating, and depending on how closely they are collaborating. This is particularly interesting when we talk at contract farming, because in a contract farming system, of course, the farmer has a business model and the contractor, the buyer also, but as they are working together in a contract mode, they also share an interlinked, integrated, inclusive business model. So you see there is a very close connection between value chains and the business model of companies that make up the value chain. Back to you.
Thank you, Andreas, for this nice explanation. Now, one more question for you. What is the significance of financial business model analysis?
Yeah, now I come to something more tricky. I mean, we've seen from the canvas that we talk about cost structure, revenue streams. We have to look at numbers, not only at the qualitative side of business models. Now, the point is, of course, we always seek higher income, better productivity, profits for our companies, the small enterprises in particular. And when we go into these questions, what can we do to improve income by investing, say, and using better inputs or better seed if it is a farm? We have to be aware of the fact that that changes the whole system, the farming system and the business model as well. The calculation part is important to see those connections. For example, if we improve the business model of a farm by innovating into production technology, using more inputs, that will obviously involve a higher cost. Means that we need short-term capital, whether it's the own capital of the farmer or borrowed capital is another question, but more short-term capital, the cash flow increases because the inputs have to be financed. Now, what does that mean for cost? The cost per input, per ton of production. That obviously will depend on the yields. If yields go up, we have more volume, and therefore the cost per unit can go down. But then if we have more volume, it also means that we have to find the buyers for it. Do buyers, do customers buy those volumes? Do we have the market for it? You can immediately see that if we think of an improvement in the value chain and something as conventional as income through better inputs, it has implications for all elements of the business model canvas. The different numbers are connected. Investment, capital needs, revenue and cost, income, profitability, all these elements, financial parameters are connected. Now, it is very important for us, I think, that when we do value chain development and we look at such innovations at the enterprise level, we are aware of those critical parameters that we have to check and that we have to have control over. In an investment into equipment, the minimum volume of products made and sold, the production scale would be a critical parameter. How much do we have to process so that an improved rice mill would make economic sense? Now, what does that mean for the volume of raw material that you have to acquire from partners and suppliers? What does it mean for the number of employees or workers that you need on a farm? If you increase your yields, you also need more people harvesting. Technical efficiency ratios, yields, transformation rates, are they really true? Are we sure that the transformation rate from paddy to rice is correct, or from inputs to agricultural products? These are all critical parameters. And we have to check them by making financial calculations that connect these elements. And I would like to again come back to the other presentation that we still have before us that looks at those interrelations between different financial parameters. That's a separate task that we have to do, and we'll hear more about it in the future. I just want to make sure that that is to be taken very seriously. Back to you, Karina.
Thank you very much, Andreas. Now we come back to you, Alfons. How can we use the business model approach?
Yeah, thank you very much, Karina. First, I would like to say that what we can do is we can help improving, or the business model approach helps us to improve existing business models. We can see to what extent the models that we have in our value chain are working well, or to what extent we would see better ways to do the business. For instance, I'm currently working personally with exporters of canned and dried fruit and vegetable in Armenia and Georgia. And there we aim to improve their business models in a way that they can get access to higher value markets in the EU. And that ranges from organizing their supply in a different way to certification in the end for the product to get this market access. And here we say we think of improving existing business models, especially for small enterprises, because we think that's something where we are more or we are better positioned as our understanding of sophisticated large companies may be limited on the other side. So number one is to improve existing business models. The second thing that we can do is to identify sustainable businesses in our value chain. Where are certain models of, for instance, green production or of inclusive business, where a company works with a large number of smallholder farmers, or we can identify social business models in the value chain, and then particularly strengthen their role in the value chain compared to others. Number three is that the business model approach can help us to generate completely new ideas, to develop new business cases. This is a bit more demanding than the first two options that I presented. But sometimes we can find reasonable, successful business models in other countries, but not in the country where we are working. And we can introduce these business models in our country. Or we develop together with the actors something from the scratch and help them to come up with these new ideas. Number four would be we can introduce technical innovations based on a holistic economic assessment. I can imagine that we have many participants in our webinar from the Green Innovation Centers. This is all about introducing innovations. And for me, it makes a big difference whether we introduce an innovation as a technical innovation or whether we have this holistic approach to see how is it working in terms of market access? How is it influencing the profitability? What kind of innovation can be introduced? How in the value chain? So there, I find it much better to see technical innovations from a business model perspective than just from the technical innovation aspect. Number five is we can support the replication of improved or successful business models. This is something where that's already embedded or part of the term business model. It's a model. And you remember that on my first slide, I talked about the business model generation. And it's a bit like somebody started with an online shop. Now this kind of business model is replicated by millions of companies. Somebody started with an organic farm with own farm shop, and this concept also is replicated by millions of farmers. So the point is to see if there's a good business model, to what extent this can be used by a larger number of actors in the value chain to generate higher income. This replication of successful business models is in the implementation of projects also a very important point. And last but not least, it's also for us a tool to check how some solutions that we are proposing for the value chain development, to what extent they are really financially attractive, profitable, so we can assess a new model of service provision based on our business model approach quite well.
Thank you very much, Alfons. Now I have one very last question for you. What are major challenges of promoting business models?
This slide is a bit the opposite of the earlier slide. The first one was how can we use it? Now, what are the challenges, the cons, the difficulties? Number one, it's a question like we already tried to start with the discussion on the first slide. Do we really have sufficient understanding of markets, technologies, and cost? Do we have access to sensible data? Can we advise a processing company on what is a suitable business model for him? Or are we always lagging behind the in-depth knowledge that a trader or a processor has? I think that's a challenge that we face quite often. Second one is the decision to invest and the risks have always to be taken over by the entrepreneur. This should be very clear. It's something we can show a certain model, we can present some advantages, but in the end, it's a risk, and framework conditions can change. And that's part of the entrepreneurial activity that he or she has to see what makes sense. Number three, I talked about replication of business models in a very positive way, so million online shops and so on. But there are also limits of replicating the business model. Like also Andreas said before, a market may be limited. Somebody may be very successful with a business model, but if there are 10 people doing the same, it's not working anymore. And even it's harming the pioneer who came up with a business model. This we also have to check, and we have to be aware of this. The next one is there may be unintended negative side effects. In my first question, I asked if we promote a certain business model, will it have a net advantage? Because we can face the problem that we successfully promote a certain business model and 10 companies employ another 1,000 people. But maybe other people outside of these companies are suddenly have a weaker market position and will sell less. If we promote a certain mechanized way of farming or of processing, some artisanal way of farming or processing will be reduced. So if we promote something successfully, we have to be aware there can be negative side effects, and there we should try to reduce this as much as possible. And the last point, but maybe one point that is very important in reality also, is very often there are many good ideas for successful business models, but do the companies then have access to finance? Will they be able to realize the investment? And I hope that there our colleagues Jens and Fabian will later on give us some positive example where they overcame this bottleneck, or we'll talk more about this.
Thank you both, Andreas and Alfons, for answering all my questions now. Before we continue with Fabian and Jens, we would firstly go back to the two statements at the very beginning that Alfons gave you, where you had the opportunity to say if you agree, disagree, if you think it's wrong, right, or why. And for this, I would like to hand over first to Anne-Marie, who analyzed all your questions. Please, Anne-Marie.
Thank you, Karina. Hello, everyone. So back to our first question. Some business models have net advantages for value chain development. If we promote these models, many value chain actors will benefit. 10 participants answered these questions, and all of them agreed that many value chain actors will benefit. especially if it's geared towards sustainability. This was one point of one of the participants. And another participant mostly agreed, but stated that there would be a need for local adoptions because there is no one-size-fits-all approach. And regarding question two, we are able to advise value chain actors on what is a good business model to invest. 7 participants answered, 1 said true, and the remaining 6 said sometimes. Especially the ones who answered sometimes had some further comments on that. As long as the final decision remains with the value chain actor, it would be a good business approach. There is need for specific and general knowledge. And we could do better in supporting downstream activities, promoting supply, but also create demand, and support the development of functioning and creative distribution models. There would be also a room for improvement in advising smaller enterprises in how to use financial business cases, because it's not sufficient to create a case. It's also important that the business owner has in-depth understanding of the model.
Thank you, Annemarie, for this nice summary. Alphonse, would you like to add here?
It shows there's a need to adopt. It shows there are certain limits. And also, going back to the comment of, I think it was Sarah Jensen, that maybe we can do better in supporting particularly downstream activities when it comes to marketing, distribution, processing, for me is also downstream, and also more long-term financial advice, financial assessment, and not just two short-term projections. This is something where I think many of us are better at farm level and to oversee the business there. And when it comes to distribution, marketing, maybe international distribution channels, concept there, when it comes to more complicated financial projections, I think there's a big weakness. So I think these points are very important for us to consider. Andreas?
Yeah, very briefly on question one. Everybody agrees, obviously, as we can see. But of course, I try to make the point that the different business models are connected. So if we take off from the value chain development idea, then it is not one business model, but it's the combination of business models that counts, how many will benefit. In some cases, it may be that if you go into one lead firm that has many connections, it can have a greater impact than going to very many small ones that are more difficult to develop unless they are integrated into the value chain. So it's the connection of business models, I think, that counts as a very important factor here.
Okay, thank you, Andreas. Is there anybody in our audience who has a microphone and would also like to comment on one of the points?
Thank you to all of you for the presentation. I have I want to say something. When you spoke about the challenge of promoting a business model, I remember an example of company. I'm totally agree that company have to take the risk because I will give you the example of the company Canon, which sell camera, old camera. When experts spoke to Canon and tell to them that there is a new digital camera, so you have to change your business in order to sell this new camera, the owner of Canon say no, it isn't true. And when the new camera appeared, the company of Canon was completely destroyed. So I'm totally agree that company have to take the risk in order to exist. That is my my remark. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much, Neila. And a nice example with Canon. Usually we are not at that level of these super big companies, but we can see that even for them, it's Yeah, the bigger the company, sometimes the more difficult it is to change the business model and to adapt to new challenges. And it shows very clearly the need to be clear and to think about the business model. Thank you very much. Is there any other comment?
Yeah, hi, Alphonse. This is Virginie. Maybe just to add a little bit of experience on using the business model canvas with small stakeholders, with the likes we work with in the green innovation centers and so forth. It is more important for me to get them to understand the steps of creating, building their canvas themselves so that they can use it as a projection tool as well. That they can see, okay, if I introduce this innovation, if it's technical, if I change my organization, if I change my supply people chain, this will impact my business model in such a way. And I mean, we're usually there at the start and we give them the tools for further on. The beauty, if I can say it that way, the beauty I found in the business model canvas is that when they finally understand how to do it themselves, then they can use it later on to do their own projection of impacts of whatever changes or innovation they want to bring to the business. That's the first positive I experienced. The second positive, I'm sure Jens and the other colleagues will probably touch upon that, but it's the connection with the financial world's lingo. Let me explain. When we start with the small stakeholders, they understand after a while the cost structure, the but they usually lack the means to describe their own businesses to the financial world, especially when they're asking for credits and so forth. And the business canvas, for me, has been a very useful, very basic first step in the financial literacy process for them.
Okay, thank you very much, Virginie. Very good points, and particularly the first one is that the use of the business model canvas by some farmers or other value chain actors. I think we should still think more from the value link side about what tools we have in our material that could also be used more directly at the level of the project beneficiaries, less for project planning for our people. But to make it useful and to introduce it at entrepreneur level, I think we could do much more there. And playing around with a business model canvas, in the end, can open up many ideas. So it can be an eye opener for many companies. Karina, I think we should move on, maybe now to our colleagues Jens and Fabian, with the project example. And just before I think Jens will start to talk, it will now be an example of a GIZ project that worked a lot on business models that developed similar tools or also other tools, which we would like to show that can complement well our value links approach. And also, we want to see some examples what was already achieved in practice there. Therefore, I think I hand over directly to Jens.
Hello, also from my side. I'm Jens. I'm working on the global project promotion of agricultural finance for agri-based enterprises in rural areas. Thank you for the introduction, Alphonse. So what I'm going to present you, and later on Fabian will follow up on that, is how we used business model analysis in order to approach financial institutions. For me, the business model is kind of like the door opener, because if we are coming with our project, we don't have to offer too much except of knowledge and capacity building. So we really try to generate detailed knowledge and hard figures, like hardcore calculation, what Thomas Breuer, who knows him, always mentioned, like we did hardcore calculations. Yeah, so we try to really calculate business models and make them like then not attractive. I mean, they have to be attractive by itself, but to present them to the banks. And so I'm going to present you now which way in theory we used, and Fabian later will tell you an exact example from Benin, cachet nursery. On the project, the title is already there. You see the objective. Our target group are emergent farmers, rural agricultural SMEs, cooperatives. One distinction is also of the project that we are very close to the green innovation centers. The project, this GEFO ACFIN I'm working for, is also under the ZEVO, One Word No Hunger initiative. And so we are only working in countries, you will see in a minute where we are working, where also the green innovation centers are working. So meaning we are focusing also on similar value chains. So we are having also a value chain approach, if you want to say so, in our project. And we are making very much use of the knowledge that already has been generated by the Green Innovation Center or other bilateral agricultural projects. And so if you think about GEFO ACFIN, you should think always of a bridge. So we are trying to bridge the supply and demand side. So we are providing services for the demand side, for farmers, for agricultural enterprises, etc. But also we are working on the supply side with a banker, yeah? How the farmer meets the banker, if you want to say so. So these are the countries of operation of the GEFO ACFIN. We started in Benin and Zambia in 2016. And last year we extended the project with another three countries, which you see there, Mali, Nigeria, and Cameroon. So, but now coming to the important part. So how are we trying to bridge this gap? And one important, and maybe the most important, is the business model analysis. So, so what we are trying to do is like to find sustainable business models and present them to financial institutions in order to attract their attention. Because this is the main thing that we are trying to do with it. And how are we going to do this business model analysis? So it starts with the value chain scoping. So this is a really field research intensive labor work. And I think it's very, very similar to what was described by Alphonse and also Andreas. So we have not created here the magic formula or something very much different. The questions I would assume are more or less the same that we ask or that Andreas, Alphonse, or like people would have asked. So it's really a kind of a cumbersome process. And then so we look for key buyers, the main actors, the value addition, prices, margins, market competition, etc. I think you know that much, much better than I do. And then in the second step, as we would pronounce it, we are already doing a pre-selection of business models where we see like which are the real economic viable business models, which is very important for us. Which business models show a sufficient market size? Because financial institutions are not interested in a business model which may be super valuable to the chain, but which only has two actors, for example. So they are looking for more a larger business model. And so to certain criteria, we do a pre-selection, and then we do what I mentioned before, the hardcore calculation, like in-depth calculations. And what I'm presenting you on the next slide is in bit more in detail what kind of tool we have developed and used for that. I just want to say like, there will be very likely a follow-up on this tool. I'm not sure if in this webinar series or in a different one, but so if you're interested, there will be more information on this. Just I don't have enough time to pronounce it like in all depth, so I can only show some parts of the tool. And here we start. So basically the tool has data entry sheets. It's an Excel tool. Where we can generate revenues, variable cost, the investments will be described, fixed cost, and then we have a financing sheet. Then there are automatically calculated reporting sheets, which I'm not going to show here, but which are there. And then we have also a simplified risk sensitivity analysis is possible with the tool. What I wanted to show you is with the tool, you can use whichever currency you want because you can input by yourself. You can apply tax rates. You can apply interest rates also on the market level, whatever is there. And then you have up to eight services that a business model or an enterprise may have. Like, for example, in this case, it's a cashew nursery. So it has eight different kind of trees. And the whole business model that is calculated here is an improved cashew nursery, just for your knowledge. But you can also choose farmers, and then you have different crops. You can add livestock. You can whatever you like to add, you can include here. And the tool is available in French and also in English. Then I'm skipping the revenues. I'm coming to variable costs. So just also to give you an idea, each sheet, we are always comparing in the model the existing scenario with the improved scenario. So we are saying the basic cashew nursery, like a generic, of course, looks like that. And then the improved scenario could look like this. And of course, you can play around with these figures. And here with the variable costs, you put all the data, and of course, very specifically for each case. In this case, the first is for the grafted cashew seedlings, and then for all the services that you had in the implementation and the general data sheet, you can add here what is necessary with inputs, with labor, with other costs. And the reference is in this case per tree, like you see per batch off, and then you could also whatever you like, per cow, per tree, per hectare. Whatever is necessary, you can include here. Then investments, you put all the necessary investments for the improved scenario. So whatever is necessary in the case of a cashew nursery, for example, like shaded clothing, irrigations, a certain transportation. So you list all and give them a price. You give them also a depreciation rate, etc. Fixed costs you add as well. And then we're coming to the financing sheet. This is where the financial side comes into play. You see here that the sheet has the total investment costs, which are input on a different sheet. So you need 3 million of FCFA, like it's not euro, don't think that. And then here you can also decide by your own, like how much own capital would be necessary that the SME, the agricultural SME, the cashew nursery has to contribute to the financing. And then you will go to a required debt capital. And all these data go right into the cash flow, which you see in the bottom line under C. Like, so of course, this is much larger, the sheet. It's only a snapshot of it. And here, this red circled element on the downer and right part, this is the cumulative cash flow. And here you have to make sure, of course, that the enterprise will not end up in a negative cash flow. So you can structure the financing according to the cash flow of the business. So you can put either investment credits or working capital loans. You can play around with interest rates, with the months of disbursement, with the repayment rate, etc. So it is a bit complicated, but also very flexible. That you can basically can calculate everything that that you need. Then I already mentioned reporting sheets. I just because of time, I'm not going to show them here. But what I wanted to show you is that we also included in the tool a small risk sensitivity analysis. In this analysis, we look what happens if the business has a rise or a decline in, for example, a sales price, the yield level, or in the interest rate. If the interest rate increases or decreases. And you will see immediately effects, and I just give you a simple example. For example, if we have a decline of a sales price by 50% for like the grafted cashew seedlings, in 2018, you will see the effects in a second. So like that on this pie chart on the right, and you will get these slides, so you can take a bit more time, that this affects, of course, the business model and the profitability of this. I cannot also tell now about there are certain limitations to this risk sensitivity analysis, but at least it gives you a first impression how the business model will react on certain external shocks. So, and then to round up already my presentation. So this is the full, six steps that we seem necessary. We were at step three, and now after calculating the different business models, I mean, before we selected and calculated, we are putting together what we call a mini business case. That's meaning like usually a PowerPoint, which we include not only, of course, the calculations, but we focus quite a lot on these calculations. But of course, we also have to describe the logic of the business model. So who is involved, what is the logic behind, etc., and then coming to the calculations, which will be shown a little bit later by Fabian. And these mini business cases or PowerPoints will then be used in a validation workshop with financial institutions and agricultural actors. And there, the business models are discussed. Basically, do they really make sense? The reality check, I mean, it would be really bad if they wouldn't make sense, because we did quite a lot of work and study before. But obviously, the people on the ground, they have to buy that. And they have to say like, okay, interesting, market size is enough, they seem to be profitable, etc. And following these validation workshops, of course, there have to be more workshops with financial institutions, like to really come then to the pilot and rollout stage of these business models. And here, I would like to hand over to Fabian to provide us with a live case from Benin.
Thanks a lot to Jens and to everybody for listening. I'm sitting here next to Andreas in Eschborn, but I have been in Benin the last 2 years. And therefore, I can tell shortly about how we use the business model analysis for getting loans for our farmers and our SMEs as target groups. And we heard about now the business model concept and different analysis tools, so the business model canvas and the Excel tool that Jens presented. And now I want to tell about how we use it, the approach of calculation described by Jens for our business models in Benin, and how we used it to encourage farmers and SME for asking for loans, for improving the business models, and to encourage microfinance institutions to finance these improvement of business models. And in Benin, we are working on different value chains in soy, in rice, in cashew, in shea, and in poultry, together with the bilateral program ProAgri and the Green Innovation Center ProSiva. And we as Project on Agricultural Finance are working on satisfying the financing needs for farms, cooperatives, and upstream, downstream SME along the value chain. And I want to give now an example of 1 hectare, an SME in the cashew value chain, which is the cashew nursery, as one input provider for cashew farmers. But of course, we analyzed the different interlinked business models along the chain. So the business model for the farmer, for the cooperative, which also can earn money by stock-taking and marketing cashew nuts. And there's also the business model of processors, of course. But now we look at the nursery that is producing and delivering grafted seedlings to cashew farmers. And after this, I can tell some more words on other business models in Benin. But first, the nursery. As we heard in the first presentation, the value chain analysis, the value chain development strategy are the first steps, which help us to identify different enterprise types along the chain, which each of them have their proper business model. And we now choose the nurseries because we recognize that one bottleneck for the cashew farmers to have more yields is better planting material. So grafted seedlings by cashew nurseries are promoted by local research, by the farm organizations, and of course by projects. But these nursery SMEs are not really known as economic actors and profitable businesses by microfinance institutions. And therefore, we saw some few nurseries producing and selling some few hundred plants, but we see high opportunities for upgrading their business model through market development for grafted seedlings. We see high potential for competitiveness of these nursery SME. We see a high potential impact for the cashew farmers buying these seedlings. But we also have to admit that this business model, cashew nursery, is not very replicable or not a mass business model because we just have a few. So we saw that for upgrading these business models of the nursery, they have different capacity development needs, but also financing needs. They need working capital for inputs and they need investment capital for equipment. Therefore, our next question from the project perspective is always, which of these nurseries are profitable and what kind of financing loan can they really get? Therefore, we did a business model analysis for an exemplary SME nursery to compare the actual situation and an improved situation. And therefore, we compared a small nursery producing 5,000 plants with an improved nursery business model with 25,000 seedlings. So how did we proceed to analyze? The consultants we had followed the different steps that Jens described and spent a lot of time to compare the profitability and cash flow of a current situation, so 5,000 plants with an improved situation of 25,000. So we took real costs of inputs and with the Excel tool, we can play with different parameters, mostly with the quantities that they produce, but also with the productivity. So here for the nursery, it's the mortality rate. For the farmer, it would be the yield. And this is giving us income statements with revenues, the different costs, and we can add additional costs for capital for loans. And this is giving us high or low gross margins and high or low profit in the end. So I will not enter into all the numbers here, but I just want to show the results of these calculations. With this quantity of 25,000 plants for an improved business model, with these costs, with a certain mortality rate of the plants, and with an assumption of prices for selling the seedlings, we have a high or good gross margin, 78%, but always depending on these assumptions that we do. For producing these 25,000, the nursery needs external financing, he needs more inputs, more labor, more equipment. As we see in the table, he needs shade, he needs fences, he needs water, he needs a vehicle, tricycle for transporting. And for this needs, he needs, of course, savings for bringing in his own equity, but he also needs a short-term and therefore feasible investment loan, 3,700 euro, and he needs, often neglected, an even much bigger working capital loan of 6,400. And these kind of calculations are important, but complicated and partly new for the SME and totally new for the financial institutions. We saw that, of course, the SME, if he's a good one, he knows what he needs, but it's not easy for him to do scenarios like we can do with the Excel tool. Perhaps he has or does simplified accounting, but it is not easy for him to do a business plan and to negotiate with financial institutions to show what he needs and that it can be profitable. And we also know that financial institutions don't know nurseries at all, don't know the potential, don't know their capacity to pay back a loan. And therefore, we took In this case, these calculations, our business model description with some slides and the calculation to convince the existing SME nursery guy and the our partner microfinance institutions of the potential gains of an investment. We used the model, the analysis, to elaborate with both sides critical financial technical parameters or selection criteria to look if and which SME are suitable or able to upgrade the business model. We also thought with them on different technical and financial services, training, handholding for this business model upgrading. And we had to adapt this optimum calculation with the 25,000 seedlings to the real capacity and interest of both the SME and the MFI to have in the end a real business plan and a real loan application of this existing SME. And in reality, of course, in the end, this looks different than this optimum calculation of 25,000 and the loan of 3,700 and 6,400, because our nursery entrepreneur in Paracou, Benin, first he did only 3,000 plants with his own money. Then we did the analysis, made a training for the bankers on cashew financing, invited them also on his production site. And then in the end, he got a loan, but just 1,000 euro, and he put his 3,000 plants to 6,000 plants, but he sold well, paid back the loan, and he negotiated in the next season 1,500 euro. Then he could do 16,000 plants, but he put in more private money and money of potential clients to do 22,000 plants in the end. So now he's not so far from the optimum calculation of 25,000 plants. So this is also what we did with other business models in other value chains in Benin. We analyzed different business models and had different results, different levels of profitability, feasibility, and scale of potential clients for our financial institutions, which resulted in priority business models that we promote more than others and adapted to these business models suitable financial product. And in Benin, we see a strong role of cooperatives and unions as actors for value chain development in general, but also facilitating loans. And group loans are much more interesting for the MFIs because less expensive, but also risky. We all know difficulties in cooperatives. But for group loans, we don't need individual calculations for each farmer, but just one exemplary calculation to have these minimum requirements or selection criteria to choose cooperative members that are able to use and pay back loans, for example, input loans for soy or rice, or group marketing loans for cashew and shea cooperatives. For individual emerging single farmers or SME like our nursery guy, we have the other business models and now some experience for coupled investment and working capital loans. For example, for the extension of poultry production, for soy processing, for rice mills, for small machinery like a soy thresher, not really for the tractor, but no example yet, but at least some calculations. And then we did, having these models like we did for the nursery, we were showing and discussing with both sides, agricultural and financial actors, the results of these models. And we thought about how to find farmers, SME, that can improve their business model and can get viable clients of microfinance institutions. And we thought on how service providers, so our trainers, coaches, or farmer organizations can help both sides and facilitate, supervise those facilitated loans and control the good utilization of these loans. Some few words on how did we proceed to set up such pilot financing collaboration schemes, because we knew that we need proofs that improvement and financing of these business models can be successful. So we need pilots. So we set up MOUs for each of the value chains and each of our five partner MFIs. We didn't give money to the MFIs, neither to the farmers or the SME, but we made contracts with the farmer organization. So for example, for the regional cashew or soy union, and they employ and pay field agents, extensionists, that can go from village to village to select potential entrepreneurs to improve the business models and to help them to go to the MFI to ask for the loan and to use well the loan and the improvement of the business models. And this was resulting in 1.5 season of facilitated loans in Benin, always with 100% money of the financial institutions. So they didn't get money from our side for credit lines or for guarantee funds. They took their own money. And therefore, it was some small money and a lot of group credits, which was much more easier for the financial institutions than the individual SME investment loans. So in the end, in the different value chains, we have some 2,600 beneficiaries. We have a lot of group marketing loans in cashew and shea. We have a lot of group input loans in soy, and we have only some few individual investment loans for SME, like the cashew nursery, for example, for soy processors and poultry farmers. And with this, I can just resume or conclude very shortly that for us, it was very necessary to distinguish what kind of business model analysis for which user we are doing, because we see that it is important or necessary to do the analysis and the calculations for average or typical farmers SME, but then also adapt to real farmers SME. We saw that it's necessary to have a business model description and calculation for actual situations with target situations or improved scenarios. We also saw that there are many different tools and possibilities to do the description and to do the calculation. So we saw the canvas, we saw the Excel tool, we saw the six steps that Jens presented, but these are just some possibilities of many potential tools and manners to present the results. And we saw that this is much depending on the aim of the business model analysis and on the user of these results. We use the business model analysis and the detailed, complicated calculations very much as a teaser or for getting the interest of MFIs. And then we want to use the business model analysis as a basis for really discussing with the MFIs on their product development or product adaptation. But this is getting much more complicated, that they really change their loan specifications or the modalities or the criteria for giving loans. We saw that we can use the business model analysis for adapting individual business plans or group loan applications for farmer organizations. We also saw that the business model analysis is giving many information, not only on the financing needs, but that it results in many information for an upgrading package. So many different needs for technical, organizational, financial improvements and needs for services. Last words, we saw that we have to continuously adapt the business model analysis depending on the different levels of capacities. So not everyone can understand all these calculations. We have to adapt it before and during and after we have such pilot financing collaborations experiences. And we have to work a lot on how to integrate and really institutionalize these tools in manuals or trainings or policies of pharma organizations, of other service providers, and of course in the microfinance institutions to have in the end products and trained MFI credit officers that can satisfy the needs of farmers and SMEs. So I finish with these words and thank you for your attention and your questions.
Yeah, thank you very much to both of you, Jens and Fabian. That was really interesting. And it was so interesting that we have now many questions. And I think due also to the time, we right away start. So the first question was actually by Joost. Where are these business model tools that Jens presented, where are they available? And Ralf asks, what competences do you need to fill the business model calculation tool? Is this done by the project staff? Maybe Jens, you could answer these two questions.
Yeah, thank you. Available, I mean, basically they are available right now, but we really want to make sure they are bulletproof. So I think we will kind of do an official launch. And what I mentioned with, we will present this tool to a larger audience quite soon, but I don't have a date yet. Yeah, and then it has to be agreed. Maybe it could be within this webinar series, but I don't want to hijack anything here. Or we will, like, of course, do it from our own project. So soon, but not decided the date. And then the second question from Ralf, who fills the form. I mean, so far it was filled by the project staff or the this consulting, what Fabian mentioned. And that was a question later, but it should be handed over then to pharma organization and financial institutions, knowing that this will not be so easy because the whole process is really time intensive and we have to create like success models, success stories. And that's in Benin, it worked well. So the financial institutions gain trust into this, let's say, methodology and in also in the tool and in the work and the knowledge, and that they then take over this work in identifying new cases. Yeah, and that is the theory. I mean, knowing that this will not be easy, but that's the theory.
Okay, thank you. Then we have three questions coming from Sarah Jensen. How do you ensure participation of the customers in the calculation process? The first one. Then which type of business are you working with, especially as you're using Excel? And the third question is, how do you deal with the high interest rates of for loans of local banks?
Ensure the participation of the customers. I mean, the customers is not using the Excel sheet. I mean, the Excel sheet is used at the moment by the consultant or later, let's say, by financial institutions or farm organizations. I mean, because this is, and that's also later a question was, it's a generic business model. So not to misunderstand, if you come only with a generic business model, no financial institution would give you a loan because, of course, you always in the end have to look at the individual because we anticipate that a cashew nursery has 5,000, but it may have already 8,000 or only 2,000. Or so the reality, and that was, I think, from Ebert Klein a question, the reality is then different. But the financial institution has to be sensitized. They have to understand what the business model is about and that it is in general is profitable. And so that they not instantly reject a farmer who is coming, a cashew nursery who is coming in and applying for a loan. Then the high interest rate, yeah, a sad story. to be honest, I would like to skip the question knowing how important it is, but I don't have an answer or a simple solution to that. There are many new ways like crowdfunding or there are KfW funds. It really depends so much on the country. And it's, I mean, it's blowing up the discussion. We would need another 2 days maybe to talk about this. I can't answer that in other words. Fabian, maybe you want to add.
Yeah, just to add on the high interest rates, this is why we need and use the calculation tool, because we can play with different parameters and we see if the interest rate is 20%, it's not no more profitable for these and that farmer or SME. But if it would be perhaps 15 or 18, it can be interesting, but only for these few farmers that have high yields productivity. So this is exactly how we have to use this calculation tool. And of course, the Excel tool and the whole calculation tools cannot be fully understood by every farmer SME or farmer organization. But it can be one step by the project or together with the financial institutions to discuss with farmers, SME and farmer institutions on which farmer can be profitable with which loan. And so in the end, it's rather the minimum selection criteria or minimum requirements that result out of these calculations that farm organizations or SME have to understand and to negotiate with microfinance institutions.
Okay, and I just saw that Eberhard wanted to say something with regard to the interest rate problem. Eberhard, please.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, the interest rate, the high interest rate is often made up of two different streams, which are important when we think about financial viability. One is the costs of banks and so on to administer loans, and of course also the demand for loans. But the second important point is the inflation rate of the country. Yeah. Because if I say grow a seedling today with the prices of today, when the seedling is ready in half a year's time or so, the prices of seedlings will be different, will be much higher. Yeah. So there is inflation inbuilt. So what I came to the conclusion in financial analysis was that I have to deduct from the interest rate that financial institutions want, the inflation rate in the country. And then, of course, the remaining interest rate is much lower, is maybe 5% to 10% maximum, or even below. And that is something that, of course, needs to be put into consideration, but not the full inflation, the full interest rate a bank wants, yeah, because of the inflation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Eberhard. Okay, then I think we continue. Next question is coming from Eberhard as well. As nurseries are often subsidized, like seedlings are given for free, how is this handled in the financial analysis? And then a question coming from Neil from Tunisia. How can we transform real cases tested on the ground into case studies? These case studies would be used in trainings for bankers and financial support services. Do we have this experience?
If there's too much subsidies in, it's no more interesting for us and for the MFI who want to promote agricultural finance on a commercial and entrepreneurial basis. And this is known by our partner financial institutions. If there's too much donor or political money inside the value chains, this is not really helpful for the repayment rate of any loan given to those actors. And therefore, we would not have worked with these nursery SMEs if they would have been subsidized too much. And therefore, for such a project as we are, in the beginning, we spent a lot of time to discuss with the value chain actors and with the MFI that it's not about subsidizing neither one side nor the other side, but to help the agricultural side to see who and what can be profitable with loans on a commercial basis, with commercial interest rates and with the financial institutions, which of these agricultural actors could be commercial clients and with your products and your resources. And for the second question of Neil, we try to use these cases and to do trainings for farmer organizations and trainings for bankers. And for the farmer organizations, we want to strengthen their role as facilitators, and we want that to be a sustainable business model for a regional farmer union, for example, which is not so easy. And we also use it for bankers trainings to, we had, for example, a 3-day training on financing potentials in the cashew value chain, where we discussed the different business models along the chain and presented also the results of business model analysis to tell them if you would adapt your financial products and even perhaps your modalities or criteria or perhaps even the interest rates, you can find a lot more clients than you do right now. So why not entering in pilot financing collaboration schemes?
Then we continue. We have one more question from Mami Raya Unarisoa from Burkina Faso. In Benin, is that approach of the business model analysis with the Excel tool used with SME business training and coaching loop support? And another question by Eberhard, would a typical nursery in Benin only grow cashew or rather grow several different types of plants?
First question, the SME business loop is one training and coaching approach that the Green Innovation Center in Benin is promoting very successfully. And in the SME business and training loop, there's also one part on elaborating a business plan and presenting it to financial institutions. And we saw that this is interesting for our partner MFIs, but we saw that in the end, perhaps it's not enough that after this SME training and coaching loop, perhaps there's some more discussion and collaboration needed between SME coaches and between financial institutions to really get some of these business plans financed. And this is where we in Benin collaborate with the Green Innovation Center to see, is it really another training which is necessary afterwards, or is it perhaps some money for the coach to follow up, or is it just some advisory for the financial institution to really know more about the sector and the value chain to accept more of these business plans? And the second question of Eberhard, perhaps is answered by looking at the slide where we have the calculation of the cashew tree nursery. We can put in the Excel tool different crops for a farmer and different products of such an SME like the nursery. So he's also producing acacia teak, moringa and others. But we saw that his cash crop or cash product should be the grafted cashew seedlings. But the tool gives us the possibility to also put in all different production systems and therefore also giving the message to the financial institution, your potential client, this farmer or this SME, is not only depending on one product to get income to pay back your loan, but he also does other stuff. And this can enter in your risk analysis or your selection criteria for this potential client.
Then we continue, some more questions. Another question coming from Mami Raya Unarisoa from Burkina Faso. In the long term, will the analysis be handed over to financial institutions or farmers or farmer groups? Then Eberhard asks, what is the difference between a typical and a real farmer or real SME? And another question by Jens Treffner from Burkina Faso. Could you please develop a bit more on the long-term vision for the facilitation to access loans? Is the facilitation provided by GIZ advisors, consultants, or by banks, MFI staff?
So the plan is to hand it over to financial institution, farmer groups, and we have to see how successful that will be, especially for the financial institutions, because it is quite some work to do. Maybe it is even better with the farmer groups, but maybe Fabian can give a little word on that. The difference of a typical and a real farmer, I also try to explain. These business models are generic, yeah. So the typical farmer, but of course, a typical farmer in reality doesn't exist because each has his or her distinctions. Like some has additional cow business, somebody has other side business, not agriculture, etc. So the real case is always different to the generic model. But of course, we have to work with certain assumptions. Fabian, maybe if you could take over then.
Yeah, the first and the third question were linked, I think, or rather the same, and are quite crucial. So who in the end will really be able to use and do business model analysis, and who will pay them for it? And it's not easy. I said our project in the beginning, we need some proofs and good examples where financing is working. So again, the piloting approach, which is necessary, but then we need to think on midterm, long-term sustainability. And as I also said, it is difficult for many actors to understand and use something like this Excel tool. And therefore, I think I'm convinced that we need different steps and degrees of details and simplifications of these tools. We saw that, for example, our regional farmer organizations in cashew and soy are able to understand and use some of these analysis tools, and that they are, after one season experience, much more able to discuss with financial institutions and also to understand their difficulties with financing the agricultural sector. Of course, we try to advise the financial institutions to look more into value chain and business model specific calculations, because of course they have their own tools, and also specific to each and every MFI, they have the tools to analyze potential clients. And these tools are sometimes specific to the agricultural sector, but never specific to value chains. It is not easy to really integrate such a value chain or business model specific analysis tools into the toolkits of financial institutions, but we will see what is feasible. And again, every service provider, extensionists of field agents of farmer organizations or SME business loop coaches can play a role. They are sometimes experienced in helping farmers or SME to do business plans or loan applications, and they could be able to use some more tools and to have some more knowledge on business model specific profitability and needs of financial institutions to understand the potential client and its profitability.
This is Andreas speaking. Just a small comment from my side. I think very much depends on who we are using that methodology for. And I would think that the Excel tool that we have should stay as it is. But it is clear that this is only fully applicable to a limited number of people, and not the least it would be ourselves, I think, who have to make good calculations in order to know whether our value chain strategies work or not. So the other applications for people who don't have the initial qualification to utilize Excel sheets, we'll have to find other communication means and do a facilitation job. But the tool as such stays as it is.
Okay, then we have one last question. Maybe Fabian, you can quickly answer that. What is the cost of support for the business model analysis?
So the analysis is one thing, and using it for facilitating loans is another thing. And we saw that there's different possibilities and tools and degrees of details. And for us, it was quite expensive now to develop this Excel tool and to do a first round of business model analysis with international consultants. So this was expensive, but this was the first step. We also, for example, for the Shear value chain, we did business model analysis with local consultants, and who just got a contract of perhaps 30 days and got some simplified Excel tools and questionnaire for asking different numbers and for developing criteria. And this also worked to a certain extent. In the end, it is much more important for us to put some money into the facilitation. But this is also not that expensive because, for example, for the soy or cashew regional farmer organizations that already had some few field agents doing technical trainings and advisory services for their farmers. And we just added some more, perhaps 5 to 10 field agents, giving them some few money for some few days to do field visits in the villages with the cooperatives. And this also worked. But there also the big question is, in a second, third or fourth season, will the farm organization be able to have some more own money to continue to employ these kind of field agents? And we saw that, for example, for group marketing loans, cooperatives and farmer unions can also earn some money. If they have warehouses to collect cashew nuts and wait some months and sell them with a tripled price, they also get some few fees, which perhaps can be the basis of having a permanent field staff. But not that easy. So still a lot of work to do in this direction.
Okay. I think we have to come to an end, but we still have one more comment from Ernest Muvamba from GIZ Zambia, who says that we are already working with some value chains and having this tool now rather than later would improve on the support we are rendering to client MFIs and farmers. And I think this comment is also quite good already as a closing remark, because it shows how the tool can be used, is useful for the different projects. And also from our discussion, where I see that there were a lot of questions to our colleagues from ECFIN, there's a lot of interest in your tool, and I think we look forward to your launching of the tool. And it would be very nice if this can be shared with the community. And I'm pretty sure that we can use it for value chain analysis well, also in other countries. Yeah, it shows the value. What I like particularly is a point that it compares existing work with scenarios, improved scenarios in future, that you can compare how much are they earning now, how much can they earn later, which reminds me a little bit of the Pharma Business School that also works based on the same principle, comparing status quo with potential improvement. And this, I think, is very strong and very useful in our analysis. And so therefore, also personally, I would be interested in this tool that we can use that. Yeah, I think thank you very much for your comments, for all the questions. I hope that we answered, or our colleagues particularly answered the questions well. According to my impression, yes. And I would like to hand over again to Karina, also in terms of closing and how our webinar series will continue.
Yeah, I also would like to thank everyone for participating for the lively discussion we had today. And I just would like to say that the next webinar is planned for mid-May. The topic is still to be discussed. So if you have any ideas or topics that you would like to be presented here, please feel free to send us an email. Yeah, and with that, I would like to close and wish you all a nice day and see you hopefully at the next webinar. Bye.